Welcome to this tutorial about command blocks. As you can see, you're in an area filled with command blocks. This is actually for a mini game called Forgotten Colonies, who's running entirely on command blocks. Works absolutely perfect. But as you can see, when you look around, you'll see three types of command blocks. You'll see a blue one, you'll see an orange one, which you probably already know, and you'll see a lot of green ones. So let's quickly grab all of them. If you use middle mouse button, you will have an empty command block, but if you actually hold Control, you can actually pick the block up with contents, and that works on pretty much every block with Control middle mouse button. Just a little trick to start the day off, and let's talk about the command blocks itself. So the first one you probably know, that's the orange one, and the orange one expects a redstone input. So let's grab some basic materials we might need for today, and a button from the menu actually. Something to know, and maybe it's good to actually show it you like this. If you do it like this, it will emit a redstone signal. If you put a block between it, it will run the command block, but it will not emit a redstone signal. So we'll get back to that later. But for now, let's do it like this. A simple command, say hi, and you'll see it says hi, and it's can actually chain to another command block. So if we use another command block, we can say, how is it going? Whoa. And if we do it like that, it says hi and how is it going. This is an effective way to do it, especially if you want some delay between the ones. However, if you don't want any delay and you just want to do it on the same tick, you kind of want to use the green one. The green one does not use a redstone signal, and it can't even take a redstone signal. If I have the green one, and even when I put it on need redstone, it will not execute it, because it expects a command block to give it an input. That's how chains work. You can put it on always active and it still won't take an input signal. And that's also because of the simple reason it uses the arrows on top of the command blocks, as you can see here. So let's take this one with Control click. Now technically you would like to try it like this, but this will also not work. A chain always needs to be put directly on top of the other one. So just like this. And now it's working perfectly. Now there's another thing you can see in the chain command blocks, actually in every command block, but only the chain really uses it, and that's actually conditional or unconditional. The conditional will only trigger, and you'll see the arrow is a little bit indented, when the previous one has a perfect execution. Let's use a command, for example, tell raw. It's not really important what's in there right now, because that's too deep in already. Let's use the tell raw command to everyone who is further than 500 blocks away, and we say hi. As you can see, it doesn't work. No player was found. So the other one can't execute, so you can't say how is it going. However, if we use it on unconditional, it will only execute the chain block, because it actually runs regardless. It gets the input from this one, even though it is a negative response, so it's pretty much like, I can't do it, I'm sorry. It still will execute because it's unconditional. It just needs to execute as soon as this one is triggered. So that's basically how the chains work. Now then we have the repeating command block. And the repeating command block will execute every tick. So that's going to be very aggressive. If you want it, you need to know what you're doing, else it won't work. What we're going to do is we're going to take two chains and put it on top of it. And we're going to use the scoreboard for this. Now the scoreboard is a little bit difficult to understand, but for this I will actually make a scoreboard objective, and we'll call it test repeat, and we make it a dummy. So we have a new objective called test repeat. Now what I'm going to do here is execute if, and that's pretty hard to understand already, but we're going to do it regardless. If score reaper eru test repeat matches 1. So this one will only trigger if test repeat matches 1. Then we'll make two conditional change, and we'll put here say it's 1. And here we actually put it on another one, because else it will just keep repeating. I can test it later as well. Scoreboard players set reaper arrow test repeat is 2. Now before we do anything, this repeat still needs one thing, and that's to be always active. As you can see, the chains are already on always active. In order to operate it, put this one on always active as well. There we go. Now it says test failed because test repeat does not match one, because I don't even have that score right now. So what I'm gonna do is we're gonna make a command block that will actually set it for me. Scoreboard players set Reaper arrow test repeat is one. And just to give a visualization to the site, you'll see there is team score there. That's actually of the mini game. We're not gonna use that. We're gonna set the display of the objectives right now in the sidebar to test repeat. And as you can see, it totally disappears because no score has been set whatsoever. So let's quickly put this one right here and let's see the command if it works. As you can see, it instantly goes to 2, and that's because I set it to 1, but this one picks it up instantly, says it's 1, as you can see in the chat, it's still there, and then sets it back to 2. So if I wouldn't do this, but if I, for example, would change it, so as soon as we set it to a 1, we are going to make a test counter. So let's make a scoreboard objective called test counter, and we name it, make it a dummy. And we're actually going to set the display to be this test counter. Now, if the scoreboard test repeat is 1, we're going to set the scoreboard players at Reaper Eru test counter 1. So this basically means we're going to add 1 point to the test counter every time this runs. So if we press it now, you'll see that every tick I'll be adding 1 to test counter indefinitely. There's no limit to that. Of course, we're going to remove this one. We're going to actually just make it empty for now. Of course, we made this on empty, so it won't execute and it won't work at all because it can't get here. And that's the simple reason. This one says, no, it's false. So what we have to do is we make this one unconditional, and we're going to make this one unconditional as well. There we go. And as you can see, it starts counting now. This is every tick. So as you can see, already in those few seconds, almost 200 ticks have passed. Almost 200 times we executed this block. Now you see what's going on right here. This is how we can easily make a clock. If you want to make a clock which takes a certain timer with commands box, we already have the perfect setup. I'm actually going to remove this one entirely. So let's put it directly on there. You see it's calculating now. We'll put it on conditional only when it works. That's much safer. So let's make a little clock. So this is the basics you need for command blocks. You know pretty much what they do and how they function. What you need to know is that 1 second consists out of 20 ticks. So if you want to make a clock that does something every 10 seconds, you need to realize that it's going to take 200 ticks for you to execute. So let's, based on that, let's build a little clock that will execute every 200 ticks. Okay, I'm going to copy this one and I'm going to put it right there. Now, the problem is if I click this one now, this one will be executed as well. You have to realize that. So you always want to put a block between it. And don't forget, when you put a block between it, it will not emit the redstone signal, so you cannot have it using redstone, but you can execute the blocks directly. I'm gonna put you on 1 and you on 2 actually to stop the timer. Let's stop the timer right now. Okay, so we have, if it's 1, the timer starts running and we'll add 1 to test counter every tick. What we want to do now is make this conditional, first of all, because else it will run every tick. And then we'll pretty much say, execute if score Reaper Eru test counter matches 200. There we go. Make the conditional. If it matches 200, we're going to put another conditional on there and instantly put it on conditional, else it starts running right away. We're going to reset test counter to 0. So basically what we're going to do is going to say scoreboard players set, or you can even reset, I think, but let's just do set Reaper Eru test counter is 0. First thing first, we have to reset the test counter entirely because we're going to make one more change, and that's namely this one. Let's copy it. I'm going to point it this way because I want to use the arrows, or we can even point it this way. And I'm going to put a chain on top of it. I'm going to add this code to it as well. That means I can now reset my own test counter to zero, as you can see. Now you see the test counter starts running because I set it to zero. And according to our calculations, if it's 200, it will reset itself to zero. See? So now you have a little clock. And that's really interesting because now you can do a lot of fun stuff. Of course. Let's stop it. Ooh, I stopped it exactly on zero. That's pretty OP. And add a new command block. Unconditional. Because a repeat will always trigger. If it's unconditional, you can never put a conditional. You can never put an unconditional on a repeat. We only did it here. This one uses many, many objectives that in turn calculate the team scores of a team. And you often see stuff like execute if, so it's blocking itself already from executing all the time. But nearly always you make sure that every repeat has only conditional on top of it. And to simulate that, actually, we have team score. You see the dredges do have 11 score. So let's go to the green team. You'll see it runs automatically. And as you can see here, based on what's happening here, it's setting it to 11, setting it to 11, setting it to 8. So you see the green home potato actually set it from 8 to 11. So that's basically how you calculate team scores. I'll make a guide on that later. So you see it goes from 0 to 8 based on what home diamond is doing, and home potato is bringing it back to 11. So we have a little clock now. What we want to do now is, for example, effect give Reaper Eru glowing for 5 seconds. Amplify doesn't really matter, just make it 5. All right, having done all this, we can now safely give it a go. And let's change the view. And on 200, we are having 5 seconds of glowing. You see at exactly 100, it stops. And there we go again. So that works pretty perfectly. And at 200, we glow again. Which will take 5 seconds, and then we stop glowing. So that's how you can basically make a timer with command blocks and the scoreboard. I didn't really go into the scoreboard yet, but I would like to do that very shortly actually. It is a very basic and fundamental tool in Minecraft, and I've been, in the past I've been looking a lot at tutorials, didn't find much because most of the things were actually outdated. And using the old system, which worked much differently. But these days, the new method is absolutely amazing and really easy to work with. Of course, you can also give this, for example, to everyone using the distance tag, for example. And if you do 2 dots before it, it means actually within the range of 500 blocks. And if you actually put them behind it, it will mean further than the range of 500, and if you remove them, it will mean exactly 500 blocks away. So that's the Minecraft clock. I hope you learned something from it. It's really not hard to do. We actually use a timer to make cooldowns. As soon as the flag buff is 1, the glow mold timer starts, and as soon as somebody on the map has a glow mold timer of 200, the flag buff goes to 1 and the timer goes to 1. And with that cooldown, they actually get several buffs when they're near their flags within a cooldown. So it works absolutely perfectly. So we use it all the time. Well, thank you all for watching. Don't forget to subscribe. And I hope you enjoyed this little tutorial.